it's about changing perceptions, breaking boundaries, reaching new heights.
PK Jr. wins the championship.
It's about passion, precision.
There's Lucas setting up now.
Perfection. It's about ambition, making history.
Remy is the FIA champion.
But still, always looking ahead.
Two for two to start the season.
The future's bright. The future's electric. This week's Street Racers comes to you from the famous Saatchi Gallery in a very rainy central London, where one of our Formula E teams, NextEV, is unveiling a double whammy. A new brand for their range of electric streetcars and the world's fastest EV. We'll have lots from this groundbreaking event throughout the show, plus... motoring in Monaco with Venturi's female mastermind. Tackling the track of the Nürburgring. And driving on thin ice in the name of climate change. Back here in London, it's a big day for NextEV, or should I say NIO. Yes, that's the new global brand the manufacturers have launched to bring their electric car designs into the mainstream. Having said that, there's nothing mainstream about this particular EV. So David, yes. You're the man that's seen this go from concept to reality in a very short space of time. Talk me through what happened.
June last year when we sat down and Martin Leitch decided he wanted to create the fastest electric vehicle on the planet. So we basically brainstormed as to what that could be, what that should be. And here we are a year and a half later and a world champion.
For the supercar fans here, what features will they experience?
It's got 1 megawatt of power. It goes 0 to 100 in 2.7, top speed at the moment 313. Those will be improved. We're not giving up, we're continuing to push and test.
You've sat in this driving seat, tell me a bit about how it all works.
It's a carbon fiber chassis, like a lot of race cars, and you know, the actual driving position is very low in the car. It's very laid back, and this, you see this, how close the steering wheel is. It really feels like you're in a race car.
I had more the mind of, okay, I'm sitting in a sports car, let's say, in a cool, fast car. As soon as I hit the throttle, as soon as I hit the brakes, and as soon as I saw how quick it does these corners, I was like, okay, I think I need to turn my race car driver mode on over here because it's really, really quick.
Around the chassis you have four electric motors, one for each wheel, and you know, that's where you get all the power, and also you can control the balance through those. So yeah, the car generates a huge amount of downforce from the diffuser. It's got a diffuser on the full length of the car, and also has this huge rear wing which is generating a lot of downforce. But then it also has a DRS system that is activated by the driver to reduce the drag on the car and create a higher top speed.
And the steering wheel reminds me a bit of the Formula E steering wheel. Was it taken from that inspiration?
Absolutely. The steering wheel was actually developed by the same company that developed our Formula E wheel.
You have the key in your hand there, but how much would it cost me to get my hands on one of these?
Well, we have an initial figure of about $1.2 million, but this really depends on interest, how many people step up to the plate to really get serious about it. We can build up to 200, so we're going to test the water, so to say, and see who's interested.
Despite its incredible acceleration and top speed, there's still the ultimate test for any supercar, the world-famous Nürburgring in Germany. Could the NIO EP9 break the existing EV lap time record?
All good.
time, 3 minutes 34 on target.
Wow, so that's how you design the ultimate EV supercar. But how about producing the best FE racing car? Well, so far it's Renault Edams who hold the key. Led by Alain Prost, they've won both championships so far and the opening two races this season, thanks to Sebastian Buemi. To improve their chances, to Cheetah this week appointed former Williams and Jaguar F1 manager David Stubbs to help with operations. Elsewhere at Venturi, there's one woman tasked with helping her team earn a first win. To find out more, street racers went to check up their setup in Monaco.
Hello, please come on in. So I'm Delphine Discay, I'm the team manager of Venturi Formula E team, and I welcome you in our office in Monaco. So here's the design office, and then we've got the garages downstairs with the workshop. Here is a small simulator we develop. Our drivers always train before each race. Here they can come whenever they want, and they can start to learn the track and the circuit and the corner. Here is the motorcycle, Vaxon. And we presented this prototype, which is fully electric, at the 2011 motorcycle show in Paris. So here is where we welcome our guests. So there's a waiting room. It's also our kitchen, so where we take lunch every day. And this is the electric motor of the land speed record car. So it's the most powerful we've developed at Venturi for the moment. And we also have the trophies we had from the Formula E. So we've got the trophy from season one with Nick Hedfeld, and we've got the trophy from season two, second place in Long Beach from Stefan Sarazen. We'll have to make some space to put more soon, I hope. We also have this room, which is the boss's office, and it's got a very nice picture of the last Monaco E-Prix, first corner of the track. It's a good race, always good in Monaco. This is a picture of the first Venturi car electric we've made. It's called the Fetish. We presented it in 2004, and that's the son of the boss just on top of the car. So it's quite nice. Let's go to the roof and I will show you the view. That's a little relaxed space when it's good weather, when it's sunny in the summertime. So on my right, you've got the Castle of the Prince, and you can see the sea all around, so that's very nice. Here you've got the Jardin Exotique of Monaco. So now we're gonna go down to the garages and see our cars. They just arrived from Marrakech yesterday. Follow me. So welcome in the Venturi garage. You can see here our Formula E cars. And soon they will depart to Buenos Aires. When we have time to get the cars in between the races, we take them back here to Monaco so people can make the service, they can clean the brakes, clean the pumps, and we make sure that the cars are always 100% ready for the race. Our president, Gildo Palancapasta, used to be a racer, so you can see his race suit and also some of his trophies. Also, land speed record on ice. We've got the Formula E development car. And here, you've got two of our prototypes called America, 200 kilowatts. Here is the real development prototype, and this one is the one we presented to the auto show in Paris. Everything you've seen here is very Venturi. You've seen our design office, you've seen the garage area with the cars, you've seen pretty much everything, so now it's time to go.
From the heat of Monaco to the cold of Greenland. A few weeks ago, we brought you these incredible shots of a Formula E car going for a spin on ice to raise awareness about climate change. But how did the team do it? And why did they feel it was so important? Well, it's time to find out in the first of a two-part special.
We are presently, globally, pumping about 35 or 40 billion tons of carbon dioxide into the atmosphere per year. We've got a choice. Whoa. Why are we taking these risks with our one and only planet? Buying an electric car is only the first tiny baby step towards solving the problem. But you've got to start with those baby steps.
It's the off-season, a busy time of year for Formula E, and CEO Alejandro Agag is excited about a new project to take an FE racing car, ship it to Greenland, and drive it on an iceberg.
It's effectively a connection, a visual connection, between electric cars, a racing electric car, and the big challenge of global warming. I think people can really associate electric cars as part of the solution.
July on the remote east coast of Greenland, the edge of the Arctic Circle. Project director Jeremy Hart has been here for weeks searching for an iceberg to drive the car on. He now has to convince FE's technical director Carlos and the rest of the team that his chosen iceberg is safe to use.
So what we're going to do is just tidy down literally a clear area here.
Yeah.
Any holes that we need to fill. I mean, in fact, what that seems to stabilise.
Undulations aren't a problem. A problem is when you fall a hole like that with a wheel.
Yeah. Yeah.
Then the car completely collapses.
Back in London, it's decision time.
Because I see all those cracks on the iceberg. It looks pretty cracked already.
Turns out there's no such thing as a flat iceberg. They're irregular, unreliable, dangerous. Would Jeremy's plan work? Not easily deterred, Alejandro elects to press on. The order is given to pack up the car and send it to Greenland. They pick the most eco-friendly journey, a total distance of 5,000 kilometres over 8 days. Local expert Nico, Jeremy and Carlos fly out to get a proper view of what has happened to their chosen iceberg. What they find is shocking.
Nico, is that the iceberg in front of us in two pieces?
It's been broken in three.
Oh,
it's two in front of us. And then the third piece is a bit to the right, the biggest on the right.
That one is a dead duck.
And we'll bring you more on that stunt next week. We're here at the Saatchi Gallery in central London for the launch of NextEV's new global brand, NIO, as they unveil the EP9, the world's fastest electric vehicle. But in the world of racing, this is still NextEV's pride and joy. And it was back in 2015 at Long Beach in California when the team celebrated its first breakthrough in Formula E.
We go green in Long Beach, and it's a bad start from Prost. Great start from Nelson Piquet Jr. He looks to the inside line, and he's going for the lead of the race into turn one. Wonderful start from Piquet Jr. He leads the tight little chicane, and that's got speed in the wall. The American has crashed, and he's going to be out of the E3 here in Long Beach. A real shame. Michael Andretti shakes his head. I wonder what's going through his head. Byrne to the inside. Prost gives him space, and Jean-Eric Byrne goes through up into third position. Can he get it stopped? Job done. Third. Look at that, that was Lucas Degrassi trying to take his advantage to go past Prost as well. They're just coming down towards turn number five. It's Jerome D'Ambrosio in the Dragon car. Buemi is through, holding the inside line. Degrassi's almost in the wall. That allows D'Ambrosio around the outside of six. That's the inside for seven, but he's lost all his grip. Goodness me.
He's going to lose it out here too. Watch onto the straight. Oh, it'll be.
Oh, and that is Charles Pic, and he's spun around. I think it's Trulli. And there's a look up the inside, he certainly has. Down into turn five, through goes Jerome D'Ambrosio, past Nico Prost. He's going into the back of him there, leaves his leg breaking far too late, and that is a touring car style move. So it's Piquet Jr., then Vern, and then side by side between Degrassi, here comes Daniel Abt. He's going to go through, and no. I think takes third place. Is it? Oh, goodness me, this is action. D'Ambrosio going past Heidfeld. Oh,
what was Nick thinking there?
I don't know.
I hate to say Nick got deserved what he got there. He was squeezing the guy into the wall. The guy's there, you can't expect him to disappear.
That's bonkers. 35 years ago, Nelson Piquet Sr. won his first ever Formula One race in Long Beach. And now, Nelson Piquet Jr. exits the final corner to win his first Formula E race in Long Beach.
You got it, Nelson. You got it, Nelson.
Delight for Next EV by Team China.
Congratulations, guys. Can't believe we did it.
A great win for Piquet Jr., who would go on to take the driver's title that year. And remember, FE returns to the US this summer with the penultimate venue in New York before heading to Montreal for the season finale. But away from the track, it's been a landmark couple of weeks for the manufacturers involved in the sport. The recent launches of electric street vehicles by Jaguar and Next EV shows a close relationship between Formula E and tomorrow's road cars. But a few years ago, the term EV was somewhat of an unknown. Back then, the hybrid car was promising to be the next step for automotive development. If somebody mentioned an electric car, you'd probably think of one of these. In 2014, an electric single-seater championship launched, inviting manufacturers to drive together towards a new style of racing.
I think this is one of the most exciting initiatives in motorsports in a long, long time.
The timescale that this whole championship has come together is very, very impressive.
For the first time, we go green in Beijing.
Fast forward to the third season and the cars are lighter, faster, more powerful. And away from the track, things have been moving a lot faster than you might think. Tesla, Next EV, Jaguar, DS, Renault, Peugeot are all pushing their electric future.
Now, when it comes to performance, out goes the internal combustion engine, and instead we have two electric drive units sitting on the front and the rear axles. They have a combined output of 400 horsepower.
They're going for it, man. You could tell that for sure that they know what the value of the future of electronic vehicles is, and they are all in.
We want to push the technology further so that if more people get involved in electric technology, it's going to get more affordable, it's going to get safer, more productive, and hopefully better for the environment.
With Formula E, you have a genuinely electric, progressive series that is furthering the development of the vehicles that we are going to be driving tomorrow.
And just look at how this development is impacting sales. We can now clearly see that the world of motoring is changing. And it's not changing with the roar of a V8 or the scream of a jet engine, but with a silent, thoughtful hum. From futuristic electric cars to building electricity for the future, we're going to head back now to Marrakesh, the setting of Race 2, where we met with a celebrity producer, rapper, FE fan, global eco-warrior, and all-round nice guy who's doing his part to light Africa. Quite literally, welcome to the world of Akon.
Oh no, yesterday was amazing, you know? And then they told me that the Formula E was happening right now. So I'm like, yeah, we gotta go, you know? Cars is always my thing, I love cars. Those fast electric race cars are just amazing to me, you know what I mean? So it's just something about electric cars that I'm really, really into.
Check the video, I tell you, these electric cars are serious, man. Y'all sleeping. All right, here they come, check it out.
My first car that I've ever owned was a Saab. I was just getting out of high school and I bought the car, and it was the craziest thing because the ignition wasn't where the normal ignition is. The ignition is actually right there where the gear shifts are. But I just loved the fact that it was completely opposite of everything out there. And everyone that got it, especially the girls, they could not believe when I'd be sitting there. They're like, you're gonna start the car? Of course, yeah. They're like, how did you do that? It'd be the simplest thing that gets them right.
Singer, songwriter, rapper. Very excited to have Akon down here on the grid.
Cars are just something that's always been around. All my fans already know it.
My constituents in the music industry know what time it is. Of course, I've always been the champ, but now they're making them an electric. So I want to be the first with a super electric car.
As an African, I always wanted to be in a position where I can come back and give back and be able to use my celebrity, use my success in a way where I can help people.
Yeah, so for the last few years, you know, my main focus has been clean energy. Pretty much more so working with Akon Lighting Africa as my solar initiative. And it's really to promote not only clean energy, but renewable energy. You know what I mean? Which is so crazy to me in 2016 that we're still looking for energy, and energy poverty is so heavy in Africa. It just doesn't make any sense to me whatsoever.
Let's go meet some more drivers real quick. Now, these are the African colors. This is what I'm talking about. How are you, brother? This is Daniel right here.
What's up, guys?
All good?
How's it going? Yeah.
Oh, I think social media is going to be the key, because the key really is really spreading the word, you know? When we do these kind of things, I always like to be in a position where we're constantly posting new things. Like, they just make a little difference. Even when you think of not making a difference, it's making a difference. You know, even all the way down to the Formula E, you may think it's just entertainment, but it's far beyond entertainment. They're showing you that this is possible. You know what I mean? We turn Formula One into Formula E, and you know how big Formula One is. So, if they can transform that to green, believe me, there's nothing they can't transform to green.
Mega nice, drück uns die Daumen, du bist Bescheid.
For those who don't speak German, he said, I'm the best artist ever in the world, I'm a superstar, so remember that.
You understand German?
What an eclectic chap. But just how eclectic is one of the drivers from MS Amlin Andretti? Time to find out. Name?
Antonio Felix Acosta.
Age?
25.
Team?
MS Amlin Andretti.
Childhood ambition? What did you want to be?
Astronaut.
And what's your adult ambition?
Successful race car driver.
Favourite country?
Portugal.
Your favourite movie?
Oh man, my favourite movie. Harry Potter.
Which superhero would you be?
Iron Man.
Your best moment in Formula E?
Win in Buenos Aires.
If you weren't a racing driver, what job would you want?
Professional surfer.
Broken any bones?
Never. Zero bones broken. I'm Iron Man, without the suit. Knock on wood.
Best dance move?
the moonwalk.
Worst pickup line you've ever used?
Oh. Like, are you okay? Yeah, do you need an ambulance? Oh, why? Because I think you're an angel and you just fell off the sky.
Oh, God, that's awful. Awful. And Antonio Felix da Costa helped start our social roundup alongside Venturi's Maro Engel and Mahindra's Felix Rosenqvist as the FE drivers were reunited in Macau. Engel has also taken a trip down memory lane with motor racing's man of the moment, showing how he and Nico Rosberg have been lifelong friends. And from the current F1 champ to a four-time winner, now running Renault Edams in Formula E, Alain Prost shows that even legends have their own hero, snatching a pick with tennis idol Roger Federer. Well, that's it from London, where a little piece of history has been made with the unveiling of the world's fastest EV. Next time, we'll come to you from the Italian city of Bologna to check out the latest models coming to the market, plus plenty more from our street racers. As always, get in touch, give us a tweet at FIA Formula E. But for now, goodbye.